We all seek truth. Well, maybe not all of us, but it can sometimes be tricky to try and figure out what's true. How can we avoid being manipulated? And how can we better understand important issues? Who do we believe, and why? This is where our scientific culture can help us. When it comes to being well-informed, it can show us the way. Using the scientific method, we can generate knowledge, and using critical thinking, we can analyze it. Plus, you don't need a lab coat to do so. Day-to-day, critical thinking helps us avoid making mistakes and being misled. So here's a guide on how to sharpen your critical thinking skills. Let's start with the basics. What's the difference between fact and opinion? A fact is true. It can be verified, proven. It is fundamental to the existence of information. A fact provides a foundation that allows us to collectively agree on an established reality. When we say, this sentence contains words, it can be verified, proven. Everyone can agree that it does. But when we say, this sentence is the most beautiful sentence of all time, can we verify it, prove it? Nope. An opinion is one person's point of view. It's a judgment that may change from one person to the next. And even if many people share an opinion, it cannot be proven. Maybe that sounds obvious, but when it comes to serious issues, it gets a little complicated. In journalism, information takes many shapes, and knowing which is which can be tricky. Let's take a news item you've read in a newspaper or on a news website, for example. Is it a fact or an opinion? To figure it out, you first have to know which section it was published in. Then, you have to know who wrote it. Reporters use facts as their source material. They report them as is, in a neutral and objective manner. When they report opinions, they're not their own. They're the opinions of the people they've interviewed. They then try to strike a balance between opposing perspectives. Columnists write from a subjective point of view. They write articles that express their personal opinion, often in the first person, I. Editorial writers also write from a subjective point of view. Their texts reflect the opinion of the people who own the publication. What about bloggers or social media commentators? You guessed it, they are sharing their opinion. On the internet, opinions are everywhere. So to put information into perspective so that we can evaluate it, we have to take into consideration what kind of information it is. Now let's talk about the obstacles that stand between us and our quest for truth, starting with our own brain. It's at the root of our first obstacle, cognitive bias. A cognitive bias is a faulty thought process that distorts our judgment. And there are many kinds of bias. Look at these two lines. Which of the two is longer? If you think it's the one on the bottom, you're not alone, but you're wrong. It's an optical illusion. The two lines are the same length. Our senses can mislead us, and we shouldn't always trust them. Naive realism is the cognitive bias that explains this. It's our human tendency to believe that we see the world around us objectively. It's innate to our species, so we must try to account for it by admitting that our senses can be wrong. There's another bias that often has us fooled, confirmation bias. Here's a common situation. You and your friends are talking, you disagree on something, you think you're right, you do a quick Google search and find the proof that you needed. You feel satisfied. That feeling? That's dopamine being released by your brain because it just processed information that confirms what it already believes. Let's say you believe in the Loch Ness Monster. You'll find sources that validate your belief, and you'll ignore the sources that deny Nessie's existence. Confirmation bias is the tendency to give more credence to information that confirms what we already think and less to the evidence that goes against our opinions and beliefs. It's not an optical illusion, it's an illusion of objectivity. To overcome our cognitive biases, we have to develop intellectual humility. We need to get used to changing our mind when we're presented with relevant new information. But that's easier said than done, because algorithms are part of our day-to-day lives. Take a friend's phone, go on Facebook, on Instagram, Google something. You'll likely see things you wouldn't see on your own phone. Now imagine what you'd see on the phone of your cousin, the anarchist, or your brother, the stock trader. It would be different. Because on the internet, reality is made to measure. The giant internet companies use algorithms to customize their platform to each individual user. These algorithms reinforce our confirmation bias by showing us content that matches our beliefs and by leading us to interact almost exclusively with people who think like us. This isolates us intellectually and culturally. It puts us in bubbles. And these companies use algorithms because they profit from them. The less we're confronted with things we disagree with, the more time we'll spend on their platforms, and the more ad revenue they'll generate. Spending all this time online can cause information overload. With the 24-hour news cycle and the omnipresence of social media, we're continuously bombarded with information. In fact, processing everything we come across would be harmful to us. That's why we have to hit pause. Instead of reading a little bit about a lot, why not take the time to learn at length about fewer subjects? Not reading past the headline is a habit that we need to change. To think critically is to go beyond headlines in order to understand a topic in all of its complexity. In our digital era, misinformation campaigns are frighteningly effective. The main strategy of such propaganda is to sway public opinion using information that is partly or completely fabricated. Dishonest entities can use your personal data to create psychological profiles, voter profiles, for example, and target misinformation to them. During the Facebook Cambridge Analytica scandal, data was stolen from millions of Facebook users and then used maliciously. Here's part of an interview with Christopher Wiley, the whistleblower who exposed the scheme.
We would know what kinds of messaging you would be susceptible to, including the framing of it, the topics, the content, the tone, whether it's scary or not, that kind of thing. So what you would be susceptible to and where you're going to consume that. And then how many times do we need to touch you with that in order to change how you think about something?
Because no one is immune to this kind of deception, we must remain skeptical. To help us out, here are Eve Baudin, Matthew Johnson, and Marie-Lambert Chan, three experts who are graciously sharing their tips to make sure information is true.
La première chose qu'on peut faire, là, c'est vraiment de cliquer, lire et visionner les publications ou les vidéos au complet. Ça, c'est super important. La recherche a démontré que 60% des contenus qui sont partagés en ligne n'ont même pas été lus au complet ou visionnés au complet. En cliquant, en lisant et en visionnant, l'autre avantage que ça a, c'est que ça nous permet de sortir de notre fil de médias sociaux pour se rendre sur le site qui a publié l'information. C'est là où on pourra avoir des indices de la fiabilité des informations qui sont publiées. Et en lisant au complet, bien, on va pouvoir s'attarder à l'écriture et voir si on nous donne des informations, des détails, des faits. Une des particularités des fausses nouvelles, c'est qu'elles sont souvent très floues. On ne sait pas qui a publié l'information, on ne sait pas qui a dit quoi, quelle université a publié quoi. Bref, quand il n'y a pas assez de détails, quand il n'y a pas assez d'informations, on devrait se méfier.
Use fact-checking tools like Snopes or other resources that allow you to find out whether someone else, a professional, has already debunked something. Find the source where the information is coming from so that you know whether or not it's trustworthy. If it's a source you're not familiar with, you need to verify the source to find out whether or not it has a good reputation and a track record for accuracy. And finally, we can check other sources to get important context about a story, to find out whether other news sources are reporting basically the same details about a story, or to find out what the consensus is among experts in that field.
Est-ce qu'on vous rapporte une seule étude? Si c'est ça, ben rappelez-vous que ce n'est qu'une seule étude. Il en faut plusieurs pour vraiment tirer des constats d'un phénomène en particulier. Si vous décidez de consulter l'étude en elle-même, est-ce qu'on parle d'un seul auteur ou de plusieurs auteurs? Avec plusieurs auteurs, vous avez davantage de crédibilité. Est-ce que vous pouvez aller dans la section méthodologie et voir, surtout dans des études en sciences biomédicales, combien il y a de participants à l'étude? S'il y en a moins de 100, posez-vous des questions. Vous pouvez également regarder la section déclaration d'intérêt. Les scientifiques doivent déclarer qui finance leur étude. Est-ce qu'il y a des intérêts privés? Ça ne veut pas dire que c'est forcément mauvais, mais ça peut vous donner des indications de ce qui a peut-être pu influencer le résultat. On est dans un monde d'instantanéité. On est dans un monde où on veut des certitudes. Je pense que d'avoir du recul et d'apprivoiser l'incertitude pourrait peut-être nous aider à faire preuve plus de compassion puis de bienveillance les uns envers les autres et envers le fait qu'on ne sait pas. On ne sait pas tout le temps.
Let's recap. Critical thinking is knowing how to distinguish fact from opinion, avoiding the obstacles that stand between us and our quest for truth, making sure that the information we come across is trustworthy. Critical thinking is an attitude, a delicate balance we have to strike between remaining skeptical and keeping an open mind. We'll leave you with wise words from Carl Sagan, the greatest science writer of all time.
Science is more than a body of knowledge. It's a way of thinking, a way of skeptically interrogating the universe with a fine understanding of human fallibility. If we are not able to ask skeptical questions, to interrogate those who tell us that something is true, to be skeptical of those in authority, then we're up for grabs for the next charlatan, political or religious, who comes ambling along.